Hey everybody, it's John with Freshwater Systems. In today's video, we're going to talk about lead. Lead in your drinking water and the dangers it creates. First of all, lead is toxic. It's an inorganic toxic metal, and it can cause damage to your kidneys, your red blood cells, and your brain. Most at risk are small children and unborn kids. Lead can be found in many places in our environment, in our air, in our water, in the soil. It's also found in things we consume, like drinking water or food. Extensively used in paint. Lead-based paint was phased out in 1978. We also used it in gasoline. Unleaded gasoline was invented or discovered in the 70s. But leaded gasoline wasn't phased out until the 90s. Bottom line is, too much lead in your system is a big health risk. So how does lead get in your water supply? Well, in the environment, lead is a unique mineral and rarely shows up in natural water supplies like lakes or ponds or rivers. The primary source for lead to get into our drinking water is actually from plumbing materials and fixtures. Lead is a very malleable product and is used extensively in brass to make it very machinable. And the old brass fixtures, copper pipes using lead solder and flux is really the source of where a lot of this lead comes from today. And even though the lead and copper rule was established in 1991, we still have a lot of lead-based fixtures and even lead pipe that are still out there serving homes today. The reason these fixtures are an issue is because water, the universal solvent, actually erodes the material that's in these supplies, the fixtures and the pipes and the solder. A prime example of this erosion happened in Flint, Michigan a few years back. They diverted their water supply to save money from buying it from the city of Detroit to a water supply right there close by. But they didn't put in force any of the corrosion control products that Detroit used. And very quickly, this little bit acidic water started eroding all of the infrastructure plumbing in the city of Flint, and their lead levels went through the roof, along with some other things. The water actually turned a murky brown. But a great example of how quickly lead can get in our water. It's been known for quite some time that lead is a problem. So from a regulatory standpoint, what's been done? In 1970, President Richard Nixon established the Environmental Protection Agency, or the EPA. Then, in 1974, the Safe Drinking Water Act was established. And the Safe Drinking Water Act encumbered everything, the whole process of getting water from a lake or a stream to your house and protecting our environment. The lead and copper rule was established in 1991, and this set maximum allowable lead content for plumbing fixtures and solder and flux. Then in 2014, for the second time, those lead levels were further reduced. Now, to be considered lead-free, these products, the wetted surface area of these products, have to have less than 0.25% lead content to be considered lead-free. Flux and solder have to be below 0.2%. So what is a safe level of lead in your drinking water? In 1991, the EPA established, with the lead and copper rule, an MCLG, or maximum contaminant level goal, of 15 parts per billion for lead. Today, the maximum contaminant level goal for lead is zero, none whatsoever. So the EPA establishes what they call a maximum contaminant level, MCL, for all kinds of contaminants that are health concerns in our drinking water. Maximum contaminant levels are enforceable. So if your supplier is above the level, the maximum contaminant level, then they have to get it below. A maximum contaminant level goal is not enforceable. That's just where they want the level to be. And sometimes just money is what holds municipalities from reaching those goals. They have to establish new treatment processes, and like everything, it costs more money. But the bottom line is the EPA and the Center for Disease Control, the CDC, absolutely agree that there is no safe level of lead in a child's blood. So what do you do? How do you know if you're at risk? Well, test your water. There are test strips available that you can buy, and my suggestion would be to test every place you drink water. That would be in your bathrooms as well as your kitchen. Do a separate test. If you're in an older home, you might have fixturing that has lead content. Another thing that if you have an older home, and this is why if the municipality says they're not putting any lead, they're taking all the lead out before it goes down the plumbing to your house, you're still at risk. Because even though the municipality gets the lead out, you might have pipe and fixturing in your house that has lead content, which makes you exposed again. So my suggestion is test your water. Buy a test strip and check all of your fixtures that you drink water from. If you want to have a right down to that accurate parts per billion test, a lab test would be best for that. Test strips are only going to give you a certain level of accuracy. They're affected by the way you take the test, the way there are other things in the water that could affect the test strip. But in any case, they're accurate enough to give you an indication of you need to take action to protect your family. Okay, so you get a positive test result for lead. What do we do now? Well, there's some technology that very easily will remove lead from your drinking water. But I would recommend point of use, and that's right where you're consuming water. So you would want a filter of some kind in your bathroom. You'd want a filter of some kind under the kitchen sink. Having a lead reduction technology at the point of entry where the lead where the water comes into your house, you still may not be protecting yourself from the fixtures under your bathroom sink or your kitchen sink. So my recommendation is whatever filtration process you decide, do it at the point of use, right where you're drawing water to drink or brush your teeth with, etc. So what are some of those technologies? Carbon filtration on its own will not reduce lead. Carbon filters, or the carbon itself, has to have a blended additive so that it reacts to the lead and captures it. Without that additive, carbon will not reduce lead. So you've got to find a carbon filter that is certified for lead reduction. Those work great and can be installed at the point of use, can be put under the sink in your bathrooms. And there's ways to hook it up directly to the cold side of your bathroom, or you can put a specific faucet, which I like best, because that way all the water that's coming out of that little faucet for taking pills, brushing teeth, is filtered for getting rid of lead. Another process that's very effective is reverse osmosis. Reverse osmosis separates dissolved inorganic minerals from water, and it very effectively reduces lead. And one of the things I tell people, especially if you have a high lead content in your water, is most reverse osmosis systems have a pre-carbon filter. And if you replace that with a lead-reducing filter, you've kind of hit a 1-2 punch on lead. And that's the product that I recommend highly. And another product that does very well at reducing lead is distillation. Distillation boils water into a steam, and then the steam returns to the liquid state, and things that will not turn to steam, lead is one of them, are left behind. The problem with distillation is purely the cost. It takes a lot of energy, a lot of electricity to boil water for 3 hours, because that's about how long it takes to go through the process to get 1 gallon of distilled water. And it's not easily sent to your refrigerator or your ice machine. So distillation is effective, but I still lean back towards reverse osmosis for the kitchen point of use application. In the links below, I've listed all the products that I recommend for testing and for filtering out lead. Be sure and reach out if you have any questions. Like and subscribe, and we'll see you next time.